Welcome to everyone. Minister Freeland, Secretary Gajardo. Now, the way this is going to proceed is I'm going to read a joint statement. Then Minister Freeland will read a statement on behalf of Canada, Secretary Gajardo on behalf of Mexico, and then I will read a statement on behalf of the United States. So this is the joint statement. Today, Canadian Foreign Affairs Minister Chrystia Freeland and Mexican Secretary of Economy Ildefonso Gajardo and I successfully concluded the fourth round of the renegotiation and modernization of the North American Free Trade Agreement. The round took place in Arlington, Virginia from October 11th to October 17th, covering 7 full days of discussions in nearly 30 groups. Building on the progress made in the prior rounds, the United States, Canada, and Mexico have substantively completed discussions on the competition chapter. Additionally, negotiators made progress in several other negotiating groups, including customs and trade facilitation, digital trade, good regulatory practices, and certain sectoral annexes. Parties have now put forward substantially all initial text proposals. New proposals have created challenges, and ministers discuss the significant conceptual gaps among the parties. Ministers have called upon all negotiators to explore creative ways to bridge these gaps. To that end, the parties plan on having a longer intersessional period before the next negotiating round to assess all proposals. Mexico will host the fifth round of negotiations in Mexico City from November 17th to 21. Additional negotiating rounds will be scheduled through the first quarter of 2018. NAFTA partners are working hard to ensure the new agreement provides a solid framework to create jobs, economic growth, and opportunity for the people of North America. Ministers have reaffirmed their mandate to chief negotiators to reach an agreement in a reasonable period of time. Negotiators will continue intersessional engagement as well as intense consultations with their respective shareholders. With that, I turn the floor over to Minister Freeland.
Thank you, Bob. And thank you also to your colleagues in the U.S. government for the kind hospitality they have shown us while in Virginia and here in Washington during this fourth round of negotiations. Just a short walk from where negotiators from Canada, the United States, and Mexico have met these past 7 days, doing the hard and important work with which they've been entrusted, is Arlington National Cemetery. You can see the rows of white crosses from the conference site. And in that sacred resting place, near the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, is the Canadian Cross of Sacrifice. It was dedicated in 1927 at the behest of Prime Minister Mackenzie King and President Calvin Coolidge. This monument honors the memories of the 35,000 Americans who trekked to Canada to serve with Canadian Expeditionary Forces in the First World War, before the United States entered the war. One of them, I recently learned, was the grandfather of our ambassador, David McNaughton. Following the Second World War and Korean War, further inscriptions were added, honoring the sacrifices of Americans who fought and died alongside Canadians in those conflicts. I think there is no greater symbol of the ties that have bound Americans and Canadians for the past 150 years and bind us still. We are more than trading partners. We are allies, neighbors, and friends. And time and again, to this day in Iraq, we have been comrades in arms. Los terremotos este año en México, los huracanes en la Florida, Texas y Puerto Rico, los incendios en Colombia Británica han visto la renovación de nuestros lazos históricos. Nos ayudamos los unos a los otros como es normal y como debe ser. Quiero agradecer a mis amigos mexicanos y americanos. Gracias. Los canadienses estarán con ustedes en momentos de necesidad, así como ustedes han estado con nosotros. NAFTA has been good for millions of citizens in Canada, Mexico, and the United States. Canada is America's top export market by far. As Prime Minister Trudeau said to the House Ways and Means Committee last week, Canada buys more American goods than China, Japan, and the UK combined. And ours is a powerful northern economy, which leads the G7 this year in growth, with our GDP expanding in the second quarter of this year by 4.5%. Though Canada does not see bilateral trade balances as a useful measure of the benefits of trade, we note that the United States enjoys a trade surplus with Canada, and goods and services, that surplus is nearly $8 billion out of a total $634.8 billion in trade. In manufactured goods, it's close to $36 billion out of a total $440.4 billion. This partnership is working. Just yesterday, the Alberta Clipper expansion project received presidential approval. This and other such projects bolster U.S. energy security. Notre relation commerciale est un modèle pour le monde. Et grâce à l'ALENA, il a généré des avantages équitables et équilibrés des deux côtés de la frontière. Il ne faut pas que ça change. Permettez-moi de vous rappeler brièvement les objectifs que le Canada s'était fixés au début de ces négociations, il y a 8 semaines à peine. Nous souhaitions moderniser et actualiser entièrement l'ALENA, car après 23 ans, il était vraiment temps de le faire. Nous voulions rendre cet accord plus innovant pour qu'un plus grand nombre de personnes bénéficient des avantages du commerce tout en renforçant les normes de travail et de protection de l'environnement et en favorisant l'inclusion et l'égalité des sexes ainsi que respect des droits des autochtones. Nous voulions faciliter la tâche aux entreprises de chaque pays en réduisant les formalités administratives et en harmonisant la réglementation. Nous voulions un marché d'approvisionnement nord-américain plus libre en rendre les déplacements des professionnels plus faciles. Et nous l'avons dit dès le début que nous défendrions et maintiendrions les éléments de l'ALENA que les Canadiens considèrent comme essentiels à l'intérêt national, tel qu'un processus pour faire en sorte que les droits anti-dumping et les droits compensateurs soient appliqués équitablement et l'exception de l'accord pour préserver la culture canadienne et le système canadien de gestion d'offres. Ces objectifs du Canada demeurent. In Ottawa last month, we made considerable progress over 5 days of talks. We managed to consolidate half the text overall. We closed the chapter on small and medium-sized enterprises, and we made significant headway in several other chapters. Between rounds, we closed the competition chapter. This hard work continued this round, for which thank you to our outstanding negotiators. I'm very grateful. That said, we've also seen a series of unconventional proposals in critical areas of the negotiations that make our work much more challenging. Our purpose here, as we have said from the outset, is to make a good agreement even better, and specifically to make improvements that help create jobs and opportunities for middle-class families in all three of our countries. Yet, in rounds 3 and 4, we have seen proposals that would turn back the clock on 23 years of predictability, openness, and collaboration under NAFTA. In some cases, these proposals run counter to WTO rules. This is troubling. We cannot forget that NAFTA has enabled the creation of sophisticated supply chains that allow our companies to make things together and sell them to the world. Nowhere is that more apparent than in our auto industry. Proposed new U.S. national content requirements would severely disrupt these supply chains, make North American producers and manufacturers less competitive relative to imports from outside the region, and put in jeopardy tens of thousands of jobs across North America. NAFTA has set a stable framework for trade and investment in North America for the past 23 years. With respect to proposals on enforceable dispute settlement, particularly Chapter 19, as Prime Minister Trudeau and I have said, an effective, transparent, and enforceable dispute settlement mechanism is essential to NAFTA. Just as good fences make good neighbors, good dispute settlement systems make good trading partners. At the beginning of the summer, Vice President Mike Pence told the governors gathered in Rhode Island that he believed a win-win-win outcome would be achieved in these negotiations. Canada believes that too. But that cannot be achieved with a winner-take-all mindset or an approach that seeks to undermine NAFTA rather than modernize it. We have a real opportunity to make improvements to NAFTA. This is absolutely achievable. Let's take the next month to continue our intersessional work and meet again in Mexico with fresh, creative perspectives. In closing, I would like to again thank Bob for his gracious hospitality this week, and I would like to thank Ildefonso as well for the very warm reception and welcome we received in Mexico City last week. Merci.
Secretary?
Thank you. Ambassador Lighthizer, thank you for your hospitality in this fourth round of negotiations. Mr. Freeland, it was a pleasure to see you in Mexico and here again. Thank you. And I also wanted to thank the negotiating teams of the three countries for their commitment to this negotiation. To all media, thank you for the coverage of this process. And let me start by recognizing and being grateful and thankful for the support Canada and the United States gave to my country during the tough and very serious consequences of the earthquakes we had in the month of September. The US and Canada rescue teams were fundamental in helping us really cope with disaster. Now, we are also thankful for the assistance that you are still providing in the aftermath of the process, and definitely proves once more that the alliance of the three nations in times of need is essential and helps to build good relationships for the future. 2 months ago, we started here in Washington the NAFTA renegotiation and modernization process. In this short period of time, we have held 4 negotiation rounds, concluded 2 charters, and reach agreement on multiple topics. In this process, all three countries have devoted time, effort, and resources, involving hundreds of officials and technical experts. However, we have to recognize that we still have a lot of work to do to continue moving this negotiation forward. To move from the beginning, we knew that the process will be difficult. To move forward in this process, it is fundamental we remove obstacles that reduce the space for an agreement. Mexico will continue working, seeking constructive and creative solutions, and being open to a dialogue. But in order for these efforts of Mexico, the United States, and Canada to be fruitful, we must understand that we all have limits. Despite our current differences, we must ensure that decisions we make today do not come back to haunt us tomorrow. Without a doubt, there might be proposals in which we do not coincide. However, our countries share a common objective, a stronger and modern NAFTA region that provides certainty for investment by strengthening, not weakening, the legal protection for job creation. That designs the trade rules that will help us to take advantage of the opportunities offered by the new digital economy, instead of focusing on trade rules that were designed for the 20th century economy. That will keep access to affordable, high quality foods, products that will meet the highest safety standards and will protect our consumers. To keep governmental contracts open to all companies from North America, to enhance market integration in the telecom and energy sectors, and that will keep our trading relationship always updated by cooperating under a modern NAFTA agreement. Mexico is convinced we can achieve a better agreement by being constructive and pragmatic. We undertook this as a win-win negotiation and not to be in a lose-lose-lose situation. None of us want to end this process empty-handed, and there is no reason for that. The three negotiating teams clearly understand our country's interest. Working together, we can find the necessary balances to achieve NAFTA consistent with the reality of our economies and societies. Mexico reiterates its willingness to continue at the negotiating table, seeking alternatives to accomplish our main goals. Ambassador Lighthizer, Minister Freeland, we'll be very happy to host you and your teams in Mexico for the fifth round of negotiations in the middle of November. Let's continue working together and let's really work for the deal that we're